Hey, LifeChurch.tv and all our network churches. A lot of times you guys ask what's going on at all the different campuses. Let me just remind you, if you are at a LifeChurch.tv campus, you're at one of 50 weekend worship experiences, and then we've got dozens of others going on in network churches. Let me give you just a brief view of what's going on, what God is doing at our campuses. In the Oklahoma City area, we've got this just passion for missions. The Oklahoma City campus, all of the micro-mission trips have been filling up in the first weekend. The Edmond campus, we've got 4 micro-mission trips going on in 3 weeks. 3 of those have already filled up. We celebrate that. South Oklahoma City campus, check this out. Out of 3,500 people worshiping there, over 2,500 people in the last year have been on micro-mission experiences in South Oklahoma City. Amazing. In Albany, New York, we've added a second worship experience. This campus has doubled in size, and over 50 students in the last month have come to Christ in Albany through Switch. Praise God. Northwest Oklahoma City, we have over 2,000 people worshiping there. This campus is less than a year old. If it was its own church, it would be named one of the fastest growing churches in America. Fort Worth is ministering to over 500 people and will be in their new building that you all contributed toward in just a matter of a few weeks. Mesa, Arizona, we've baptized 52 people this year. That's 1 in 8 of people who are attending have been baptized. 1 out of every 8 people worshiping there have been baptized. Hendersonville, Tennessee, we've seen 70 straight weeks of people coming to Christ every week for 70 weeks straight. The Internet campus, we're starting Internet home churches around the country. One just started in Florida, 1 in Minnesota, 1 in Germany, 1 in Costa Rica, 1 in Iraq, all over the world. We've got the Tulsa campus has grown over 1,400 people in the last year. Rumors are there could be a new campus one day in Tulsa. Also in Wellington, Florida, we have over 400 people coming. We've baptized 3 different times in the last 2 weeks, once in a pool, a couple times in the ocean. We haven't lost anyone yet in the ocean, which is good news. And in Stillwater, Oklahoma, we're ministering to over 2,000 people there every weekend in the new building. Thank you for being a part of leading people to become fully devoted followers of Christ. Let's go to week number 3 of Supernatural. For those of you with your Bibles, let's open them up to Mark chapter 5. We're in the 3rd week of our series called Supernatural. Where have we been? Week number 1, if you'll remember, we looked at the reality of spiritual warfare. Week number 2, we looked at the power of the Holy Spirit. Next week, we're going to examine the role of angels in our lives. Today, we're going to look at Satan and his demons. To get kind of a broad overview of what demons can do, let's look at a story that's found in Mark chapter 5, and we'll see just how powerful demons can be. We'll start in verse 2. Scripture says this: when Jesus got out of the boat, a man with a what? All of our campuses say it aloud. A man with an evil spirit came from the tombs to meet him. This man had lived in the tombs, and no one could bind him anymore, not even with a chain. For he had often been chained hand and foot, but he tore the chains apart and broke the irons on his feet. No one was strong enough to subdue him. So here we see a regular guy who is possessed with a demon, and he is so strong, so powerful, that even chains cannot subdue him. All of our campuses, how many of you watch Heroes? Anybody watch Heroes? We're talking about Siler right now, okay? This was one bad dude, so strong no one could contain him. Verse 5 says this: night and day among the tombs and in the hills, this man, he would cry out. And what would he do? Read that aloud. He would cut himself with stones. Do you recognize? Here we are 2,000 years later, and what do we see a lot of people doing today who are hurting? What are they doing? They're cutting themselves, right? Why? Because our spiritual enemy, his mission is to steal, kill, and destroy. Interesting, isn't it? Let's read on. Verse 6, when he saw Jesus from the distance, he ran and he fell on his knees in front of him, and he shouted at the top of his voice, "What do you want with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? Swear to me that you won't torture me." Verse 8, for Jesus had said to him, "Come out of this man, you evil spirit." If you'd like to read the rest of the story, it's rather interesting. As Jesus cast out this evil spirit, the spirit revealed himself and said, hey, there are many of us, and our name is Legion, for there are many. And he basically negotiated a deal with Jesus. He said, cast us into something else. And so Jesus actually cast all of these demons into a herd of pigs. Why pigs? Because there were no cats around. Everybody knows you cannot herd cats. Had there been cats, that's where Jesus would have sent them. Jesus sent them into this herd of pigs, and the pigs then ran over the edge of the cliff, and thousands of them ended up drowning as Jesus cast out this demon that had so possessed a man that his strength was greater than any humans could even recognize. Now, some people might say, Craig, do you believe in demons? And the answer is, absolutely I do. People might ask, well, do you think you've ever encountered demons? And my answer would be, probably way more often than I realize. I'll give you an example. In fact, I kind of wrestled with whether or not to tell this story because you might kind of look at me and go, you're weird, okay? But many of you, you've already thought that for years, so I'll go ahead and tell it to you anyway. When I was in college as a brand new believer, we had a group of people that would gather in a Bible study, and someone invited this guy from campus that was, let's just say, a little bit odd. He was into things that most would describe as rather unusual and kind of dark. And so this guy came to this little Bible study, and at the end of the study, we gathered around in a circle. There were about 20 of us, and we started to pray. I happened to be sitting by the guy who was a bit unusual. And so, you know, I'm holding hands, which is never my favorite thing to do with another guy, especially that I don't know. We're sitting in this circle, and someone across the room was praying for something, and I thought, I'll pray for this guy who's sitting next to me. Not out loud, mind you, but in my mind. So in my mind, I was praying, God, you know, this guy's unusual. I pray that you'd help him, or something like that. And when I did, very true story, God is my witness. This guy, he shook my hand, and in the middle of prayer, he looked at me, and he said,
don't pray for me.
Okay. So I did the natural thing, and in the middle of the prayer meeting, I lied to him, okay? I lied, bold-faced lied, and said, I'm not praying for you. I don't know what you're talking about. And the prayer meeting continued, and so I prayed more in my mind. Oh, God, I don't know what's going on here. I pray for him, and he stopped me again. He said,
I told you, stop praying for me.
True story. So I lied again, second time in the same prayer meeting, and I kept on praying. God is my witness, this happened. I was praying in my mind, not out loud, and the third time he grabbed my hand and he said rather violently, he said, I told you, stop praying for me, and then he spit in my face. He spit in my face. I'd already sinned twice, so I thought three is no big deal, and I took my hand as hard as I could, and I nailed him in the chest. He was sitting Indian style, and he fell backwards on the ground, and he started making all these very unusual noises. Well, there was a guy there named Danny Chambers, who was a youth pastor in town of a more charismatic church. Danny's senior pastor of a church now in another state. Danny came up and said, come out of that guy in the name of Jesus Christ. And he started praying, and this guy was on the ground making all sorts of unusual noises, and finally, he just kind of went, pah. And it was over. And later on, we asked him, do you remember what happened? You spit in my, that wasn't very smart, spitting in my face. And he didn't remember anything, and it was the most unusual and impossible to describe experience that I could ever imagine. And I'm convinced that we were dealing with some sort of demonic force. The spirit world, as we've studied in past weeks, is very, very, very real. And today, we want to get kind of a broad understanding of what is the goal of the forces of darkness. Let's start today by taking a look and trying to answer the question, where did Satan come from in the first place?
Scripture teaches us that Satan wasn't always the bad one. In fact, years and years and years ago, Satan was actually an angel. One of God's best and most beautiful angels, known as Lucifer, or often called the Morning Star. What happened? Satan, in his beauty, became jealous of God and wanted to be like God. Instead of like Jesus, who said, Father, thy will be done, Lucifer, this Morning Star, the beautiful angel, said, I will, I will, I will. Five times in Scripture, we see this angel wanting to be like God. Here's the account. It's told in Isaiah chapter 14, starting in verse 12. Scripture says this, how you have Fallen from heaven, O morning star, son of the dawn, you have been cast down to the earth, you who once laid low the nations. You said in your heart, I will ascend to heaven. I will raise my throne above the stars of God. I will sit enthroned on the mount of assembly. I will ascend above the tops of the clouds. I will make myself like the Most High. And God said, no, you won't. No one can ever be like me. And when this beautiful angel said, I will be like you, God, God cast him out of heaven, and a third of the angels followed him. Most believe these became the demons today. Revelation 12 gives us this account, starting in verse 7, 8, and 9. The Bible says this, and there was a war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon and his angels fought back. But he was not strong enough, and they lost their place in heaven. Verse 9 says, the great dragon was hurled down, that ancient serpent called the devil, or Satan, who leads the whole world astray. He was hurled to the earth, and his angels with him. When Lucifer said, I will be like God, God said, no, you won't. There is none other like me. He was cast down to the earth, and now we have this force of darkness to deal with. His name is Satan, and his angels became the demons. Now, as we talk about this today, we have to recognize the reality that not every bad thing is because of demons. For example, if you had a bad hair day, that doesn't mean that your hair is possessed with demons. Come out of me, you demon of bad hair. If your kids are acting up, you don't need to cast a demon out of them every single time. It could be that they need a nap, or they're just teenagers or whatever. So not every bad problem is because of demons. But what we do want to do today is we want to look at a few of the things that demons do. Let's look at four. If you're taking notes, the first one is this. We need to recognize that demons influence the leaders of nations. Demons, if you're going to try to influence somebody, one of the greatest places that you could make a dent would be if you can influence the leaders of nations. Maybe you look around as you watch the world news and you're going, man, what's going on? This just seems so dark in some countries. Well, behind those leaders might be some demonic forces trying to bring about the will of Satan. Daniel chapter 10, verse 13 helps illustrate this. Remember, we looked at this verse in week number one. Context of it was this. Daniel had prayed. And for 21 days, for 3 weeks, nothing happened. And then an angel of the Lord came to him, and he said this, but the prince of the Persian kingdom resisted me 21 days. What was this? This was an evil prince, an evil spirit who was doing battle in the spirit realm. Scripture goes on to say, then Michael, one of the chief princes, came to help me because I was detained there with the king of Persia. Behind the scenes in the spirit world, we see demonic forces trying to influence the leaders of governments. That's why when you look throughout history and you think about some horrible events, you think about the Holocaust, you think about genocide, you think about today in places all over the world where the leaders of governments will persecute and take the lives of anyone who claims the name of Jesus, what do we have behind this? We have the forces of darkness. Demons at work trying to influence the leaders of nations. What else do they do? Demons also desire to inflict suffering on you. They desire to inflict suffering on you. I'll show you a story in Scripture, and as you read it, those of you with kids or grandkids or neighbors with kids, I want you to think about a 6-year-old or a 7-year-old or a little boy or a little girl, and imagine this little child doing stuff like trying to throw themselves into a fire or trying to jump into a pool in order to drown themselves. This is exactly what was going on in the time of Jesus. We pick up the story that tells us this, Matthew chapter 17, verse 15, that this father who's beside himself says to Jesus, Lord, have mercy on my son. He said, he has seizures and he's what? Say it aloud. He's suffering greatly. He often falls into the fire or into the water. Why? Because this evil spirit is trying to kill this little boy. What happened? Jesus said, bring the boy here to me. And then Jesus did what? Say it aloud. Jesus rebuked the demon, and it came out of the boy. And what happened from that moment on? This little boy was what? He was healed.
Here we see Jesus confronting a demon who is trying to destroy the life of a little child. A kid. If you can recognize that demons will do that to children, what do you think they want to do to you? They want to kill everything that matters to God. Demons, the princes of darkness, they try to influence the leaders of nations. They try to inflict suffering on you. Another thing is this. Demons scheme to lure you away from God. They'll study you. They know your weakness. And they want to do anything possible to lure you away from God. It could be that you like shiny things. Look at this little shiny thing. It could be that you're vulnerable to skin. It could be that you like to pursue intellectual ideas that may take you away from God, or spiritual enlightenment. The demons will use anything possible to lure you away from the truth of God. Here's how it's described in Scripture, 1 Timothy 4:1. The Spirit clearly says that in the later times, some will do what? Some people will abandon the faith, and what will they follow? They will follow deceiving spirits and things taught by whom? Taught by demons. What are they trying to do? They're trying to influence the leaders of nations. They're trying to hurt anyone that they can hurt and destroy. They're trying to lead you away from the truth of God. They're very, very active. I'll give you another example too. Let's just do this for a minute. All of our campuses, if you guys could just be totally silent for a moment. And I want you to listen very, very carefully. I want you to listen as if you could hear the battle raging in the spiritual world. Just be silent for a moment and just listen. Ah! 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 Got you. Did I? Some poor guy in Mesa just wet himself. Sorry about that, okay? Now, what was I trying to do? I'm totally sorry. I was trying to illustrate what demons want to do. A fourth thing, if you're taking notes, is this. Demons want to paralyze you with fear. They want you to go through life worried, in agony, always concerned about something. Some of you live there right now. You're in agony about your kids. What's going to happen to my kids? You're worried sick about school. You're paralyzed with fear about your health or the health of someone that you love. You're worried, what's going to happen? What's going to happen to my marriage? You're in agony about your spiritual condition. Why? Because Satan, through his demons, is trying to paralyze you with fear. Here's what Scripture says, 2 Timothy chapter 1, verse 6 and 7. Help me out. For God has not given us what? Scripture says, for God has not given us a spirit of fear, but of power, and of love, and of a sound mind. A spirit of fear is a very real spirit, but it comes from the evil one who wants you to live paralyzed by fear. Understand this, and never ever forget it. Satan and his demons, they hate you, despise you, want to take you out, want to destroy you. And you must be ready to do battle, and to do battle God's way.
How do we do battle against the forces of darkness? Three things that we need to know. The first one is this. We never treat our enemy lightly. No matter what, we never treat our enemy lightly. In fact, look at what Scripture says in Jude verse 9. But even the archangel Michael, when he was disputing with the devil about the body of Moses, did not dare bring a slanderous accusation against the devil. But he said to the devil, "The Lord rebuke you." Even when the glorious archangel Michael was battling against the devil, he didn't trash talk the devil saying, "You're nothing, you're a punk, you're UGLY, you ain't got no alibi, you're nothing." He didn't do any of that. He said, "This is ultimately the Lord's battle. The Lord rebuke you." We never treat our enemy lightly. It's a great story you may want to read sometime in Acts chapter 19. It was about seven sons of Sceva. And they thought they were able to cast out demons in the name of Jesus, even though they didn't really even know the name of Jesus. One time they found a demon-possessed man, and they approached him and said, "In the name of Jesus Christ, whom Paul preaches, come out of him." And the demon inside of this man looked at the seven sons and said, hey, we know who Jesus is and we know who Paul is, but who are you? And scripture says this one demon-possessed man whipped seven other men so badly that these men came out of the house naked and bleeding. This story teaches us the principle that we never treat our enemy lightly. Second principle is this: we don't flirt with darkness. We never ever even flirt around with the things of darkness. For example, maybe as a kid you did what I did. We used to play this little game where you'd take a person at a party and they'd lay down on their back and we'd say, light as a feather, stiff as a board. Light as a feather, stiff as a board. And then we'd put two fingers under them and we'd try to lift the person up. And then we'd have seances where we'd turn off the lights and we'd call on the evil spirits, or we'd play with a Ouija board, you know. Well, spirit, will she go out with me? No, she will not. And we did all sorts of things like this. The scripture teaches us that we should never have anything to do with the forces of darkness. We don't mess around with seances or by consulting mediums or spiritists or look at tarot cards or play with Ouija boards. We don't even look at our horoscopes. We don't watch Teletubbies. Okay, I'm just joking about the Teletubby things. But we never ever flirt with darkness. Why? Here's what the Bible says. Deuteronomy 18, verse 10, 11, and 12. Let no one be found among you who practices divination or sorcery, interprets omens, engages in witchcraft, or casts spells, or who is a medium or a spiritist, or who consults the dead. Anyone who does these things is detestable to the Lord. We don't treat our enemy lightly. We never flirt with darkness. The third thing we need to remember is this: we don't fight with our power, but with God's authority. We never fight in our own power, but instead in the authority of God. There's a big difference between our power. Our power is not great enough, but we fight in the authority of God through the name of Jesus Christ. Here's what scripture says, Matthew chapter 10, verse 1. The Bible says that Jesus called his 12 disciples to him, and he gave them authority to drive out evil spirits and to heal every disease and sickness. Jesus didn't give his disciples his power. He gave them authority to do it in the power of Jesus. And there's a big difference. For example, if I went out in the middle of the street and decided I was going to stop traffic and I just started telling everybody to stop, most people would probably look at me and say, who is that guy and why does he think he's doing this? You don't have the power to make me stop. But if I was dressed in a uniform and had on a badge and then said, stop, traffic would stop. Why? Because I was stopping traffic in the authority and in the name of the government that stands behind me. When we do spiritual battle, we don't battle with our own power, but we battle in the authority of the name of Jesus Christ. For greater is the one who is in us than the one who is in the world. In his authority and by his power, we can have victory against the forces of darkness. There is a battle, and the battle is real. The kingdom of light against the kingdom of darkness. What do we know? Number one, we don't treat our enemy lightly. Number two, we don't even flirt with darkness. And number three, we don't fight with our power, but with God's authority. Recognize this. There is an evil force that is more wicked than you could ever imagine that wants to steal, kill, and destroy everything that matters to the heart of God. The demons want your family, your marriage, your children, your finances, your health, and your relationship with God. Bottom line is, they want you. The forces of darkness, Satan, is described as a roaring lion seeking someone, anyone, to devour. His mission is to steal, kill, and destroy. Therefore, you do battle not in your own power, but in the authority of who you are in Christ.
How do you fight? You fight with the spiritual weapons of warfare. You fight with faith. And ultimately, you fight with the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. How did Jesus do battle with Satan? When Satan tempted Jesus after 40 days of fasting, Satan came up to Jesus and says, Hey, are you hungry? You want some Twinkies? Here's what you do, Jesus. Why don't you just turn these rocks into some bread? And how did Jesus respond? Jesus said, "It is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God." Even Jesus did battle with Satan with the written word of God. Satan came back to him a second time and said, Hey, do this. Why don't you just throw yourself off the edge of the cliff and let the angels catch you? God will do that for you. Again, how did Jesus battle? He said, "It is written, thou shalt not put the Lord your God to test." Ever. With the word of God, he defeated the lies of the evil one, and Satan came back again. Why? Because he doesn't give up easily. And so he said, Jesus, why don't you do this? Here is the deal of the century. All you have to do, bow down. Bow down, Satan said, and worship me. And when you do, I'll give you everything that your eyes see. And Jesus fought back and said, "It is written, you shall worship the Lord your God and serve him only. Away from me, Satan." And Satan fled. Scripture goes on to say, then the angels of God came and ministered to Jesus. There is another world that is as real or even more real than the world you see with your eyes. How do you do battle? Never in your own strength, but in the authority of who God says you are in Christ. Everything else, remember this. James chapter 4, verse 7 and 8. You're going to do battle? Here's how you battle. Scripture says this: submit yourselves then to God. There's some of you right now, if you'd be honest, you say, "I'm not submitted to God." Maybe partially, maybe kind of, sort of, but not all the way. Here's what you do. You submit yourselves to God, Scripture says. And then you do what? All of our campuses say it aloud. What do? You resist the devil. And what does he do? Scripture says he'll flee from you. You submit yourself to God. You resist the devil. Go. Get away. It is written. You have no place here. You can't touch my family. Get away. And Scripture says he's out the door. He cannot stay. And then the Bible says, when you come near to God, he will come near to you. That's what we're going to do right now. In the name of Jesus, Satan has no right, no place in our lives. We're going to draw near to God, and we're going to let him win the battle. All of our campuses, let's pray together. Father, thank you for who you are. Thank you that we fight from a position of victory in Christ instead of simply for victory. And God, I pray today that supernaturally you would do things that only you could do, and you'd get all the glory and the honor for it. All of our campuses today, as we talk about this, some of you may recognize right now, and you might say, honestly, I feel like we're under attack. There's so many things that are going wrong in our lives and around us and the people that we love. We feel like we're under spiritual attack. The reality of it is, you may very well be. The forces of the kingdom of darkness are trying to take you out, and you might just say, you know what, Craig, would you pray for me? And the answer is, I absolutely would. But let's just pray together. Let's take a moment and do battle in the spiritual world. At all of our campuses, those of you who would say, yeah, I'm under attack and I really need prayer today, would you lift your hands right now? Just lift them up high, all over the place. A ton of you. Let's just go to God together in prayer. Father, thank you for who you are. Thank you that you are all powerful, that you are all knowing, and God, that you are ever present. God, we thank you that just as Daniel prayed and you act in the spiritual world, that you are acting right now, releasing your angels to do battle on our behalf. God, I pray for everyone today who is under attack. God, that you would give them victory. God, that as they put on the helmet of salvation, the breastplate of righteousness, and the shield of faith, and the belt of truth, and the shoes prepared in the gospel of peace, and that they would have the sword of the Spirit, the word of God, and they would pray in the Spirit on all occasions. God, I pray and I thank you that when they pray this way, God, that you will act and you will move on the behalf of your children. And God, I thank you ahead of time for every spiritual victory that comes through your Son, Jesus Christ. God, do battle on behalf of your children. And we praise you and we thank you for it. Still praying today at all of our campuses, there are a lot of you that if you were really honest right now, you'd say, you know what? There is a battle going on for me. There is a battle right now in the spiritual world going on for many of you, and you can feel it. There's something that's drawing you to God, and you know it. You're feeling drawn to God. Let me tell you what that is. That is the Holy Spirit of God. Scripture says that you are drawn to God by His Spirit. And then there may be some little voices in the back of your head going, oh, that's stupid. Don't buy into that religion stuff. You don't need Jesus. There's no such thing. That religion's just a crutch. Don't even go there. And you're being pulled back and forth. What's happening? There is a battle for you. God wants all of you. And Satan wants all of you. What is God's story? Here's how much God loved you. He sent His only Son, Jesus, who was born without sin and lived a perfect life and died on a cross, shed His blood. On the third day, He was raised from the dead. He ascended into heaven. He's seated at the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. He's praying for you to say yes to Him. But the bottom line is, you have a choice. Who wins this battle? God or Satan? Who gets your life? God or Satan? Some of you right now, you're going to say, you know what? Today's the day. Jesus, I believe you're the Son of God. I believe you are the Savior, and I want you to be mine. Jesus, I surrender my life to you. Satan, get back. You cannot have my life. I surrender my life to you, Jesus, in every way, every part of me. Jesus, be the Savior and the Lord of my life. That's your prayer today at all of our campuses. Would you lift your hands high right now? Lift them high all over the place and say, yes, Jesus, save me from my sins.